The following is a presentation of Unidentified Entertainment and 22nd Century Radio, Manassas, Fairfax, Washington, D.C.
Exopolitics and ufology, religion and science, time and space, hosted by Mike Smith.
Do you look in the sky a lot?
This is Time and Space, hosted by Mike Smith.
Housekeeping! I'll come back later.
Find us on the internet, timeandspace.us, and Time and Space Radio Show on Facebook.
We'll soon find out that some wizarding families are better than others, Potter. You don't want to go making friends with the wrong sort.
You're listening to Time and Space on 22nd Century Radio.
There will be no foolish wand-waving or silly incantations in this class.
Find us on the internet, timeandspace.us. And don't forget, download our free smartphone app.
I've always admired your courage, Harry. But sometimes you can be really thick.
You're listening to Time and Space on 22nd Century Radio.
Now, if you two don't mind, I'm going to bed before either of you come up with another clever idea to get us killed. Or worse, expelled.
Oh, to be young and to feel love's keen sting.
Shut it!
And now here's your host, the American picker of the conspiracy theory dumpster, Mike Smith.
The heart is a blue. Shoots up through the stony ground. There's no room, no space to rent in this town. You're out of luck. And the reason that you had to care, the traffic is stuck. And you're not moving anywhere. You thought you found a friend to take you out of this place. Someone you could lend a hand in return for grace. It's a beautiful day.
Soccer Post DC is where the big box ends and service and expertise begin. Find the soccer gear you need from Nike, Under Armour, Adidas, and Diadora. Located on Route 50 in Chantilly, Virginia at the Greenbrier Shopping Plaza. Soccer Post DC, 703-817-1110. Open 7 days a week. Visit SoccerPostDC.com and find them on Facebook. Exclusive supplier to Herndon Travel and the George Mason University Patriots. Soccer Post DC. College in lovely Franklin County on this cool November day. Again, this is Mike Smith and the Time and Space Radio Show. We were trying to fight our way through a couple technical issues, but we'll mess with it later on. I'm here with an entire class of students, so welcome all students. We appreciate you joining us. And once again, Dr. Lana Whited has joined us on the show. Welcome back to the show again, Doctor.
Thank you. Welcome to Ferrum.
We are trying to talk a little bit about the Harry Potter class this afternoon, and I'm going to go ahead and start with something we were just talking about a couple of minutes ago. I'm wondering, first of all, if you could explain a little bit about the class, what it is that the students are studying, what the agenda has been so far through the semester.
The class is English 207. It's a course in our sophomore literature sequence. All students at Ferrum take at least one course in literature. It's a 200-level course. The course title is Harry Potter and the Hero Myth. And our primary purpose in the course is to look at Harry Potter in the context of Western hero myths, such as the Arthurian legends, the Odyssey. In the first half of the course, we read the Epic of Gilgamesh, just to talk about the pattern of the hero's journey and the hero's character, and then to kind of assess how Harry Potter fits into that tradition. So in the first part of the course, we read some standard Western hero stories. Then we looked at some theory by people, including, of course, Joseph Campbell, to sort of map out what the hero's journey is like. And in the second half of the course, and this is the exciting part for me, the students are giving presentations on works that they've chosen on their own to try and apply what we've discussed thus far to other heroes.
Now, when you came up with the concept for this course, what was the process? Explain the process you went through where you went to the administration and said, I'd like to do this, I'd like to teach this.
The process is that initially the course had to be approved by the English faculty, and then it goes through the process of our curriculum committee and on to the full faculty for approval.
And did you get any kind of pushback on the way?
No, I didn't, but I do remember when I first started studying Harry Potter, I made a presentation based on a paper that Catherine Grimes and I had written at a Children's Literature Association conference in Roanoke. And there were at that time, that was 2001, there were at that time some people who were very serious children's literature scholars who were insisting that they had not read the Harry Potter books and didn't plan to read them. Because I think there's a kind of a prejudice that if something is too widely successful, popularly successful, that probably is an indication that it's not really quality. I think there's kind of some elitism involved in that.
Right. And in the course of designing the lessons for, in the process of designing the lessons that you were going to teach, did you model it after programs at other universities or colleges? Were you aware of other courses? And you were able to maybe gain access to some of the information on how other professors had approached this?
I'm aware of a few courses at other colleges and universities. Phil Nell, who is a major figure in Harry Potter scholarship at Kansas State University, has a course that I think is called Harry Potter's Bookshelf that is more broadly about different subgenres of literature that are reflected in the Harry Potter series, like the boarding school book, for example. I believe his students read Tom Brown's School Days or another boarding school book, and they talk about lots of different types of literature that are similar to Harry Potter. So I am familiar with some other courses of that sort, not so much courses that are specifically about the identity of the hero in the hero's journey.
Right. Is this the first semester that you've taught this class?
It is.
This is the first time. This is the very first set of students that you've dealt with.
Yep.
That's pretty good. And what's the reaction, from your perspective, what's the reaction been from them so far?
Well, I think there's been a lot of enthusiasm. There's an awful lot of talking in class, and sometimes it's kind of hard to manage everybody talking at the same time. But I think that reflects a positive thing, which is lots of good ideas. A thing that's interesting to me about students who are readers of fantasy is that I find students who are readers of fantasy are always reading fantasy. Even if they're carrying 19 credit hours, they generally have a book going. I think I have two or three students in this class who've actually written full-length fantasy novels. So, a lot of...
It. We were going to try to talk about that a little bit later. Sure, absolutely. All right, so how about the reaction from the students and faculty here on campus, you know, since the whole thing has sort of started up? Has there been any response to it at all?
It was very popular last spring when we had pre-registration. In fact, at that time, there were several students who got into the course who had to be added after the class filled up. Subsequently, the registration dropped just a little bit, and I think there were some other issues. But a lot of interest in terms of people just talking to me about how things are going in the course, and they're aware that the course is going on.
Right. All right, let's move on. I have a news story I was trying to pull up here, and I think maybe if you guys have been paying attention to the cycle a couple of weeks ago, this crossed the wire. I thought it was very, very interesting. There's apparently a school that's out on the West Coast. I believe it's out near Portland, Oregon, and it's a big private boarding school, big, gigantic place, and it's being referred to now as Hogwarts. This is apparently some sort of a school that's run by Scientology. There's a very tight connection to the Scientology community. There has been for a few decades now. And apparently you work your way through this school and become something called a Sea Org, or part of what they call their Sea Org community. Do you see, the reason I'm bringing that story up is because of the strange connection to Hogwarts. They tried to paint this picture of it being this big magical place, but instead it turns out. What's your reaction to a story crossing like that?
Well, I think that's very interesting, and I think it just reflects again the popularity of the Harry Potter series, but Rowling certainly didn't invent the boarding school experience or the experience of, you know, that kind of training that's intended to produce a certain kind of person.
Sure. And finally, before we get to our first break, I just want to ask if you could tag a couple of students here and talk about who we have with us specifically today.
We have a few students in the class like Carrie who are English majors, and we have some other students who are majoring in a pretty wide range of disciplines. I said most students at Ferrum take at least, they have to take one literature course. They may take a second one to meet our writing intensive requirement, and so we have some students in the class who are taking it to meet the writing intensive requirement. I think we also have a fair number. If you would just put up your hand, if you're taking the class just as an elective, not to meet any particular requirement. So we have a couple who are taking the class just because they love Harry Potter and because the topic seemed interesting.
Now, with a small show of applause, if you've either seen all 8 movies or read all 7 books, give me a little round of applause there. So almost the entire class.
You know, that is an interesting thing about the class. We read only Harry Potter and the Deathly Hallows. It was my expectation that students would have read all the other books prior to coming to the class. So literally, I assume they will have read at least 6 books before they come to the class.
Not to be forgotten over here to my left, please say hello to the executive chef of the show. His name is Mike Fay.
There you go.
Mr. Fay was kind enough to join me this weekend. He's been a huge help on this project, and I love having him along when we're doing stuff. Mike and I are talking last week, and he says to me, I still haven't read the last book, Deathly Hallows. I said, what are you going to do about that?
Uh-oh.
He says, well, I guess I'm going to have to go get a copy, but gosh, you know, I really hate to go out and spend the money, especially this late in the juncture. There's a long pause, and he says, I really wish there was a place that I could go where they had all the books that anybody would want, but you didn't have to actually pay for them. You could just borrow them, read them, and then go put them back. Wouldn't that be awesome if such a place existed? Those are called libraries, Mike. It's fine.
You know, I noticed yesterday, most of the movies on YouTube now are rentals. They're not actually movies that you purchase. And it's interesting to me, even though we are very clearly in the era of ebooks, there still aren't a lot of businesses online that are renting out books for people to have, like, for a limited period of time. And I'm not sure why.
Now, are all the Potter books on Kindle? None of them are on Kindle yet, is that correct?
They're not on Kindle. They're only available as ebooks through the website that Rowling launched last month, which is called Pottermore. And it's interesting, when I saw the announcement about that website and they said they would be making available the Harry Potter books in electronic format, I hadn't realized they weren't available in that format, but they weren't. They're available, of course, as audiobooks, but no, they had not been available as ebooks. And I think that website is still getting launched. I'm not sure whether those are available yet.
I think it's being launched as we speak, yeah, exactly. I also heard that the DVDs are all going to be out through the holidays, and then they're being pulled.
Right.
Everything.
And they're being advertised right now as a kind of a boxed set.
Right. All right, great. You're listening to the Time and Space Radio Show. My name is Mike Smith. We're coming to you live from Ferrum College. Right now we're doing the part of the show called Harry Potter Class. We're here with Dr. Whitehead and her students. We're going to take a quick break, so just stay with us, and we'll...
Take me to Yardie Town. Take me to Yardie Town. My head hurts.